Atrophic gastritis is a chronic inflammatory disorder which affects the parietal cells and leads to a progressive mucosal atrophy. And there are a few crucial features of atrophic gastritis that we have to know. First of all, atrophic gastritis affects corpus and fundus of the stomach. Antrum typically is not affected. Helicobacter pylori is considered the major provoking factor of autoimmune aggression. And to explain why, we have to know the pathogenesis. So here we have stomach, its parietal cells. We know that parietal cells have hydrogen-potassium ATPase. This transporter provides secretion of hydrogen ions into the lumen of the stomach, where hydrogen binds to chloride with formation of hydrochloric acid. And hydrochloric acid has a few very important functions. First of all, it's acid, and as any acid, it causes decreasing intragastric pH. Also, hydrochloric acid provides oxidation of iron from +3 charge into +2 charge, and we can absorb only +2 charge iron. So hydrochloric acid participates in iron absorption. In addition to this, we require hydrochloric acid to convert pepsinogen into pepsin, and pepsin provides proteins digestion. Also, parietal cells produce intrinsic factor, and intrinsic factor is absolutely essential for vitamin B12 absorption. So parietal cells have huge role in digestion. What we have to know is that all our cells undergo stringent control by our immune system. All cells are obliged to present a small parts of them on their surface. This presentation occurs by MHC2 receptors, and cells that provide phase control are T-helpers. So T-helpers come to parietal cells, bind to MHC2 receptor, and check, for example, for small parts of hydrogen-potassium ATPase. In normal condition, T-helpers do not see anything suspicious in hydrogen-potassium ATPase, and thereby they do not react. The same process occurs to intrinsic factor, where parts of the intrinsic factor are presented to T-helpers, and because T-helpers do not see anything wrong with the intrinsic factor, they do not react. But sometimes something can go wrong. The most common risk factor for autoimmune gastritis is Helicobacter pylori. And the reason is that Helicobacter pylori, with some environmental factors, can a little bit change the structure of hydrogen-potassium ATPase or the structure of intrinsic factor. We call this process post-translational modification. And now, when T-helpers come to check is everything normal with parietal cells, they cannot recognize hydrogen-potassium ATPase in modified state, and thereby they begin immune response. The same thing occurs in case of intrinsic factor. T-helpers cannot recognize intrinsic factor in modified state, and because of this, they begin inflammatory reaction. When T-helpers becomes activated, they activate B lymphocytes. Activated B lymphocytes we call plasma cells. And once B lymphocytes becomes activated, they begin to produce autoantibodies. It's antiparietal cells autoantibodies that target hydrogen-potassium ATPase together with parietal cells. And inflammation of parietal cells with time will cause their death, and thereby secretion of hydrogen and intrinsic factor into the lumen of the stomach will decrease. Also, B lymphocytes produce anti-intrinsic factor autoantibodies. These autoantibodies target intrinsic factor together with parietal cells. As a result, inflammation of parietal cells develops that results in their death. And without parietal cells, we cannot produce hydrogen and intrinsic factor. So what are the consequences of parietal cells injury? First of all, without parietal cells, we cannot make hydrochloric acid. As a result, the absorption of iron decreases, and this will cause iron deficiency anemia. Also, pH inside the stomach will increase, so it will be more alkaline. Activation of pepsinogen will decrease, as a result, proteins digestion will decrease, and decrease in production of intrinsic factor will cause decrease in B12 absorption, As a result, B12 deficiency anemia will develop. In addition to this, one autoimmune reaction increases the risk of other autoimmune reactions, especially the ones that affect thyroid gland. Nowadays, to make a diagnosis, we use diagnostic criteria. And the first criteria is to check for Helicobacter pylori, because we know that Helicobacter pylori is a major provoking factor for autoimmune gastritis. The second criteria is to check for anemia, and we know that it can be iron deficiency anemia and B12 deficiency anemia. The third criteria is to check for other autoimmune pathologies, because we know that one autoimmune pathology greatly increases the risk of others, especially check for Graves' disease. The fourth criteria is the presence of autoantibodies. In case of atrophic gastritis, it can be anti-parietal cells autoantibodies and anti-intrinsic factor autoantibodies. The last criteria is related to endoscopy. With endoscopy, we check for Helicobacter pylori density. Typically, the higher the density, the more severe is the atrophic gastritis. We also check for inflammatory activity. The higher the infiltration of the mucous membrane by pro-inflammatory cells, the more severe is the atrophic gastritis. With atrophy of the mucous membrane, the amount of glands decrease. So the more severe is the atrophic gastritis, the lower is the amount of gastric glands. And in the same time, the more severe is the atrophy, the more intestinal-like looks gastric mucosa. We call this intestinal metaplasia. Here we can see how atrophic gastritis progress. So initially we have normal mucosa, then superficial gastritis develops, then superficial gastritis progress to atrophic gastritis, where we can see decrease in quantity of glands and changes in gastric epithelium. And the last stage is intestinal metaplasia, where stomach mucous membrane begin to look like intestinal. What we also have to know is that atrophic gastritis cause increase in blood gastrin level that significantly increase the risk of neuroendocrine tumors. So to explain this, we know that with atrophic gastritis, the amount of parietal cells decrease. The lower the amount of parietal cells, the lower the hydrochloric acid secretion, and thereby the higher the gastric pH. Increase in gastric pH stimulates G cells to produce more gastrin. As a result, the level of gastrin in the blood increases, so hypergastrinemia develops. Increase in gastrin overstimulates enterochromaffin-like cells that in response to this begin hyperproliferate. And exactly hyperstimulation of enterochromaffin-like cells cause neuroendocrine tumor. So to summarize, in atrophic gastritis, decrease in hydrochloric acid production causes increase in gastric pH, and decrease in intrinsic factor production causes B12 deficiency. In addition to this, decrease in hydrochloric acid production causes decrease in iron absorption, which causes iron deficiency anemia, and also increase in gastric pH stimulates G cells to produce more gastrin. As a result, hypergastrinemia develops. And increase in blood gastrin level significantly increases the risk of neuroendocrine tumor. Up to this day, the only approved treatment option remains eradication of Helicobacter pylori. The logic is that if we remove the initial factor, the entire process of post-translational modification will decrease, and thereby immune response will decrease, and with time autoimmune aggression will completely stop.